Good afternoon. Welcome to our program on the American Mythology of Racial Progress. I'm delighted to see so many Academy members who have joined us for this conversation. I want to begin by thanking the New Haven Program Committee, in particular its chair, Frances McCall Rosenbluth, for organizing today's program. Under Frances's leadership, New Haven has become one of the Academy's most active committees, alternating between planning public lectures like last December's Steps Toward International Governance and convening more intimate member gatherings like our conversation today. Frances's creativity and thoughtful approach has been a model for other local program committees across the country as they seek to build community and connection. We're grateful for her service to the Academy, which extends beyond her leadership in New Haven to include time spent as a member of the Council and the Committee on Studies, co-editing last winter's Daedalus volume on women and equality. Today, Frances has provided us all a fantastic opportunity to hear from one of our newest Academy members, Professor Jennifer Richeson. Jen is the Philip R. Allen Professor of Psychology at Yale University, where she also serves as Director of the Social Perceptions and Communication Lab. Her research focuses on social group membership and the ways race, gender, and socioeconomic status impact behavior. These insights into the psychological dynamics of prejudice, inequality, and injustice are essential to our understanding of how to address our biggest societal problems. Jen was awarded a MacArthur Foundation Fellowship in 2007, a Carnegie Foundation Senior Fellowship in 2020, and is the latest winner of the Sage Kaspis Award at Stanford University, which named her one of the most consequential social scientists of the 21st century. She was elected to the American Academy in 2020. Our event today is inspired by Jen's article in last September's Atlantic Magazine with the headline, "Americans are determined to believe in Black progress, whether it is happening or not." The article explores the enduring and misleading narrative that our nation's history is one of linear, uninterrupted progress toward racial equality, a narrative that absolves us of the responsibility to actively combat racism and blinds us to the ways in which progress can be reversed. Jen argues that occasionally, as has happened in the wake of the killing of George Floyd, this myth is exposed, creating a window of opportunity to truly address systemic inequality. At the American Academy, we have been compelled by the clarity of this year to reflect on our own 240-year history, acknowledge the ways our institution has contributed to injustice, and identify ways we can advance equality going forward. Last September, the Academy's Board of Directors approved a statement on anti-racism and created a standing committee to advise the board on the pursuit of three goals: that the Academy's membership and leadership are fully reflective of the racial diversity of American excellence, that nothing we do as an employer continues the legacies of white supremacy, and that all our projects in service to the common good consider the role of racism. Recent Academy initiatives like the Commission on the Practice of Democratic Citizenship and the spring issue of Daedalus on Immigration, Nativism, and Race in the United States are just two of the more recognizable ways in which our work aligns with these principles of anti-racism. As the statement says, we have no difficulty being proud of the American Academy's achievements and letting that pride guide us. But the price of taking pride in those achievements is also accepting the burden of our failings and reckoning with the parts of our history that do not fit neatly into the sanitized narrative of progress. Today's event is an opportunity to further dismantle the corrosive mythology of racial progress and discuss how our nation can capitalize on this moment to produce real and lasting change. We've reserved a significant amount of time for group discussion to follow Jen's remarks. I encourage you all to participate at that time by using the raise hand function to indicate that you have a question. Now, please join me in welcoming Professor Jennifer Richeson.
Thank you so much, Patrick, Frances, for inviting me, the New Haven team, and to David for that incredible and thoughtful introduction and the connection to the American Academy. I really appreciate that. And I'm so excited to have this conversation. These are thoughts, ideas I've been thinking about for some time, but they're still in development. And I really look forward to hearing what other Academy members have to say and think about all of this. And certainly, you know, think about what we should be doing right now to grapple with this mythology and maybe dismantle it in the service of achieving greater equity. So today, I want to start by introducing you to this gentleman. His name is Bob Smith, in the interest of all disclosures. He happens to be the father of a good friend of mine. But what's remarkable, there are many things that are remarkable about him. But what I want you to note now is, this is Bob. At the time, he was 75. And this is a photo taken of him on June 3rd, 2020, in front of a federal courthouse in the town he lives in now, Gulfport, Mississippi. And it was, he was moved to engage in what turned out to be a one-man protest in the wake of the murder of George Floyd. And, you know, what, you know, there are many incredible, you know, things to say about this, including that he was so moved to do this. He did this on his own. He stayed there all day. But the least surprising thing about it was that he was protesting, for Mr. Smith was also one of the people who was protesting and then severely beaten in Selma, Alabama in 1965 in what is now considered or called Bloody Sunday, as a member of the Student Nonviolent Coordinating Committee. So as the story of Mr. Smith's protest just this past June and his enduring commitment to protesting and standing up for racial equity, you know, sort of got some attention, including this attention in the local media, but also social media attention, it was really interesting to pay attention to how people responded. One response was, you know, sort of inspired by this image, was, wow, not only are we, the collective we, still fighting the same battles, some of the very same people are literally still standing up and protesting. And while it's inspiring, and, you know, this one man, or many people actually, who are on the front lines then continue to go out to protest, it does, you know, some require us to think carefully about, what does this mean for the progress we thought we had achieved? You know, maybe for some it means nothing, but for many, it was the, you know, the first time where they questioned whether or not we've made the type of progress we often claim to have made, certainly since the 60s. So this moment, you know, allowed, you know, us and me in particular to think about this mythology of racial progress, or this narrative we have in our country about our racial progress, right? And, you know, and as, you know, David alluded to in the introduction, the argument goes something like this. You know, we have this belief in our country that, you know, if we look across time, I'm gonna, you know, graph this in a schematic because I'm a social scientist and I like graphs, but, you know, there are many metaphors for it. We use an escalator in the Atlantic piece, but it's that across time, right, we acknowledge that there have been some ugly, you know, parts of our past where we were not so racially equal. Sometimes people cite slavery. Oftentimes people go to the Jim Crow and then the civil rights movement as that time. But that across time, we're naturally and, you know, quite linearly moving towards racial equality, with the, you know, with the acceptance of some potential inflection points, right? So for some people, again, depending when you start, that inflection point is the civil rights movement of the 1960s and the Kingian dream, you know, dream speech, that incredible and important legislation of that era. For other people, that inflection point was and continues to be the election of Barack Obama as the first Black president of the United States. And these points are always turned to as, oh, okay, now we've mostly made it, or we've gotten whatever obstacles out of the way, and that is going to, you know, lead us, you know, we're back on track. In fact, the track metaphor is great because it means we're automatically moving, you know, sort of barreling maybe towards equality. Okay. So this idea, or this narrative of racial progress, right? Many people have talked about it, from Derek Bell, the legal scholar, sociologists have certainly been talking about it. And I want to suggest that not only that it exists, but that it's important because it really constrains what we see in terms of the racial equality that exists in our country, right? Or our lack of attention to it, in this case, our perceptions of racial equality. And those perceptions shape what we believe may be necessary to achieve actual equality, right? And sometimes the what we believe is necessary is nothing, right? If it's happening naturally, automatically, in some sort of predestined fashion, okay? So what I wanna do just in the few minutes to sort of just frame the conversation is talk about some of our data bearing on this narrative of racial progress. And I'm gonna do it in the, looking at how people think about or their perceptions of racial economic equality. So this is a big series of, a large sort of series of work that we've been doing in my lab with collaborators. And, you know, it really just boils down to this question of what do people believe to be the case, to be true about racial economic equality in our country today and at various time points. So we asked this of a nationally representative sample of American adults. And, you know, a very straightforward question. For every $100 of wealth accumulated by the average white family, how much wealth has the average Black family accumulated? Because we didn't want people to have to, you know, think too much about this or too hard about, you know, about it. You know, not everyone enjoys fractions. We really made it easy for them to respond with this slider scale from 0 to 200, where, and we said 100 means racial equality, right? The average Black family has the same amount of wealth as the average white family in the United States. Okay, so we asked them about the year 2016, which was when we were doing the work. And then we asked them about several years, 11, in fact, other years in our country, okay? So what we did then was we compared participants' responses, ultimately, to federal data, right? So we only use years in which there were accurate federal data based, you know, on national surveys on these this wealth gap. Okay. So I'm just going to show you what we found. You know, this effect has been replicated many times, but I just want you to see a couple of things. First, I'm going to plot in red people's perceptions, so those estimates. Okay. And then the yellow will be the federal data, right? What I'm calling reality, right? The best estimates we have or the best benchmarks we have for what is actually the case in each of these time points. Okay. So this is what people thought, right? Okay, and this is reality, all right? So a couple things to note here. One, people are really wrong. they don't know, not aware, not willing to admit. We don't know, but we think people largely don't know, okay? And this is true in the past. This is 1963, which is really an estimate of white versus non-white wealth, I'll just say, but that is largely Black Americans in those estimates. Okay. And people thought, you know, back in 1963, that the average Black family had about 50% of the wealth of the average white family. In reality, the average Black family had about $5, right? For or 5%, right? If the average white family had $100. Okay. And you can see because there's been little change, right, across time, people are especially wrong, even more wrong, when you ask them about a time point closer to right now, right? So in this case, it was 2016, and you can see that on average, respondents thought that the average Black family had almost 90% of the wealth of the average white family, right? That the gap has largely closed, okay? So, you know, these are some of the data, not only, but some, right? You can see the linear trend here, right? But some of the data suggesting this mythology of racial progress, right? That it's out there for sure, right? Lots of people have said that, right? But it's also patterning how we think about concrete disparities, in this case, the racial wealth gap. I just want to note something else. You know, here, this estimate for 2016 is really huge, right? And really, really hugely wrong, right? The number is closer to 10%, right? And it's so glaringly wrong. It's as if I looked out and said, oh, actually, you know, the sky is purple or yellow when it actually is nice and blue outside in New Haven today. So that's really wrong and really wrong to be walking around the world with this, you know, this type of estimate, right? Or this type of idea, okay? But I wanna say a couple of things about it. One, this is the most wrong we've ever seen participants in any study, right? No, this is really, really wrong and sort of an outlier in terms of how wrong people tend to be. If you just ask people, what's the average, what's the Black white wealth gap in this way, they'll say something closer to 70%. Black families have on average 60 to 70% of the wealth of the average white family. So it's interesting that and why people are so wrong in this sample. And in other work I'm not going to talk about in detail, it's in part because of this mythology of progress. So when you ask about multiple time points, people get locked into what they said in the past, which is around 60%, right? You see in the 80s. And so then they have to increase their estimates of equality in the present in order to conform to this linear structure, right? And so they're sort of pushing themselves, or I should say, we are pushing ourselves because we all do this toward greater inaccuracy, right? Almost bizarrely inaccurate positions because we're trying to stay committed to this racial progress narrative. Okay. So it's in part because Americans falsely believe we have achieved considerable racial equality Americans falsely believe that we've achieved considerable racial equality. And this is in part due to our commitment to this racial progress narrative, but the reverse is also true. We are committed to the belief that America has achieved currently considerable racial equality. Okay? And they both are important ideas. Okay, so just gonna be quickly, I said everybody does this. This is true in our sample, no matter how you broke it down, every type of person on average shows an inaccurate, right, inflated, overestimates the current racial, Black-white racial wealth gap. Okay. It does happen to be a case though that white Americans do this more, right? The magnitude of their overestimates are greater than racial minority Americans. High income Americans also do it more than their lower income counterparts. That's across the board and also within race largely. So the question, we've been asking lately is why? And, I'd love to have the conversation to be, some of these questions of why is this? Of course, there are some socio-structural explanations that we are examining, like the fact that we live in incredibly racially and socioeconomically segregated spaces, right? This is true of the poorest of the poor and the wealthiest of the wealthy, right? They're sort of living in different worlds. And it turns out we organize our lives such that we don't encounter people who live very differently than we do. Most of us, at least many of us, and the extent to which we don't do that. So people with more socioeconomic and racial diversity in their networks tend to overestimate these things less, okay? They tend to be more accurate in their perceptions, right? I'm a psychologist, right? So of course we spend a lot of time in continuing to do this, looking at the cognition or the motivated cognition that is undergirding this. I'll just, tell you about a couple of things. One, this mythology of racial progress is very much connected to our commitment to the American dream, hence the very Americanness of this, right? This belief that if you want something, you work hard enough, you go and get it, period. That's what's required, of course. If there are structural barriers, especially patterned by race or some other characteristic that's unrelated to hard work, then of course it threatens belief in the American dream. So, it should not be surprising that people who believe in the American dream or similar ideas, this is one called just world beliefs, measured with things, items such as, I think basically the world is a just place, right? So they're not structural barriers to getting ahead in life. It turns out the more people believe in this, the greater their overestimates of racial economic equality. Okay. And that's true for Black Americans, and it's true for white Americans, right? And it's equally true, okay? So again, we're motivated, or those who are most motivated to believe that the world is fair and just, right? Meaning discrimination is not a barrier to getting ahead, are also most likely to overestimate current racial economic equality, right? To see society right now as fair and just. So the last thing I want to say here before we open it up is there's also a motivation to believe in the racial progress narrative, okay, itself, and to believe, again, that society has reached racial economic equality. So, you know, we wondered, given this belief, right, this belief in progress, if we disrupt it, right, can we disrupt it first? And if we do, will people rethink what is true about the present, right? Will they say, oh, wow, okay, if racism still exists in society, maybe in different forms, but still limits opportunities in some fundamental ways, okay, maybe current state of American society is not as equal and just as I thought, and temper their estimates, okay? So we sought to test this. You know, we randomly assigned, in this case, a sample of white Americans to read about the continuing legacy of racism from the 60s to today, right? And of course, that racial inequality persists and racism persists in various ways. Okay, so we just told the truth about it, but did so in a way that was meant to connect the past to the present in a way that would temper perceptions of racial progress. Okay. Then we asked them to make estimates, again, same slider of racial economic equality in the past, 1963, and in the present at the time, 2016. Okay. So what we did then was look at participants, right, their estimates of progress by subtracting these equality estimates in 1963 from their estimates of 2016, right? So you can see how much progress they think there's been. Okay. We also compare this to actual federal data. Okay. So what I'm going to show you now first are their overestimates of progress. Okay. So we've subtracted out how much has been in reality. Okay. And then I'm going to show you their overestimates of actual equality in 2016 and 1963 as a function of this condition, right? Whether or not they read about racism before doing this or read some control information. It was about being left-handed, okay? So first, did we disrupt the progress narrative? Yes, it seems we did a little bit, okay? So participants who read about racism, right, before they made these estimates, those are the people in red, tended to say there had been less progress than those who were in the control condition, right, in the blue. The key question is, did these, you know, perceptions of current racial wealth equality become more accurate, right? We disrupted their perception of progress. Yay. Did it affect their perceptions or their beliefs about the present? No, not one bit, right? So these are their participants' overestimates of racial wealth equality, right? So they're overestimating the Black-white wealth gap, right? Or underestimating it by like 60 percentage points, right? So they're really wrong again here, okay? And that doesn't differ by condition. What they did do though, meaning those in the racism treatment condition, tended to also overestimate equality in the past, in 1963, more than their counterparts in the control condition. Okay, so what does this mean? They acknowledge there had been less progress, but instead of saying, oh, that means the present must not be as equal as I thought it was, they did something like this. If we have not made as much progress as I thought, then perhaps racial inequality in the past was not as bad as I thought, right? Changing the perception of the past to fit the present in order to say, okay, not as much progress as I thought, okay, sure. I'll acknowledge that. That means the past wasn't so bad. And, you know, in case you're wondering why I'm a psychologist, this is why. What? Wow. How can this be? And we did replicate this to make sure this was not just some fluky thing. Okay. So just to close, let me, you know, hope you, do you agree with me that disrupting this progress narrative is not enough to get people to see, acknowledge, absorb the actual racial equality that exists in our communities and our society right now? Because we have these commitments to the misperception of racial economic equality and the mythology of racial progress, and it's staggering. So, you know, before I get roasted, I'm one, not saying that there has been no progress. Of course there has been, right? But our perceptions of it outpace reality. And we tend to cling to and remember the wins and forget about, not don't attend to, fail to attend to, you know, what might be considered challenges, you know, backsliding, you know, losses, threats to that progress. All right. It's progress is an important idea, right? This, you know, of course, this Kingian idea of the, you know, arc of the moral universe is long, but it bends towards justice. That's an important idea to hold on to believe, you know. But Barack Obama also reminded us that while this is true, the arc of the moral universe may bend towards justice, but it's not bending on its own. It's people doing the bending, right? It's people agitating, right? And the very cues that there has been progress are often triggers for those who want to bend it the other way. It's animating backlash at every turn. So thank you all for engaging in this conversation. Thanks for the invitation to talk about this here. And if you want more information about what we're doing, here's the, how to contact me on Twitter, at Yale, my lab. Looking forward to just the discussion we're going to have. Thanks so much.
Thank you, Jennifer. A superb talk, very thought-provoking. I'm sure there will be some very good questions. Please do feel free to use raised hands if you have a question you want to ask. Let me actually start with the first question. Have you looked at any comparative studies of other countries? And is there anything to the idea that Americans are just naturally American exceptionalism, that we are optimistic, we always think everything is getting better, whereas, say, Europeans are cynical and they think the world is always getting worse? Or I'm leaving aside the specifics of racial issues. Is there any truth to that or not? I'm just curious.
Great question. So we have not looked at this kind of thing in other countries, although other people have recently looked at it in Canada, which, you know, does that count? And they seem to show it too. But I think the part of it that could be, and, you know, we should test this, uniquely American, or at least especially American, is our commitment to the American dream, right? That is so fundamental and foundational. Are also, as my, you know, former colleague at Northwestern, Dan McAdams, would say, we're very into redemption narratives. And this is the best one going, right? The redemption of America's original sin to, you know, where we are now, or at least where we would like to be, think of ourselves now. So that's fundamentally American, you know, period. But I should also say, this is a broader, you know, I'm using the race one for any number of reasons, in part because of what's happening in our country right now, but also the racial wealth gap is so staggering, and it does directly connect to our original sin and then our, you know, poor efforts to recover from it or not, including Jim Crow. But this is true of any what people perceive as social progress. So there's a general sense that gender equality in any number of domains has gotten better faster and more linearly than is the case. It's true in other domains, not just economics, right? It's also true of people's perceptions of employment, a number of women on boards, number of Black Americans on board, right? So it is the broader social illusion of linear progress and a real commitment to the belief in that progress, and it outpaces the reality of that progress.
Thanks. Let me start in inviting a few people to unmute yourselves who've raised hands. So Seth Pollock is the first hand I see up.
Thank you, David. Jennifer, it's so nice to meet you virtually after all these years. And thank you for such a lovely talk and such stimulating and innovative work. I had a question for you, which is, when I was listening to you present your data, one of the things that occurred to me was this age-old problem of the availability heuristic. And you know, the same reason that people worry that childbirth is dangerous. You know, we remember things that are outliers. And so, you know, do white people think of Oprah and Vernon Jordan and Condoleezza Rice? Is this the reason that they don't really process the data? They process what's available. And what my question is, the Academy has been hosting some conversations and discussion about the potential benefits of a national service plan where young people would actually all do some kind of equal kind of volunteer work prior to going on after high school. And I'm wondering what your thoughts are. Would something like this, would people having to gather outside of their neighborhoods or their more limited social networks help this? Would it provide more in-your-face data about what our society is really like? Or do you think that this is so baked in that people will still see what they want to see or what they need to believe?
Great, great questions. I'm going to try to tackle them both. The first about availability. So we're actually about to run that study now. That's what we have some anecdotal evidence for, that when people are literally asked to make this comparison in the Black-white gap, they do call to mind Oprah or LeBron James or, you know, these high wealth people. I should say, so we do have some data that we publish that's very consistent with that idea, looking at misperceptions of the Asian white wealth gap. So if you, before people do that, you encourage them by, you know, information to call to mind less prototypical Asian Americans, refugees from Cambodia versus the more prototypical, immigrants from China, or you can do this in other ways, different immigrant narratives. You do see those who were led to think more about the heterogeneity of the Asian American, you know, group, and especially to think about these different prototypes, different exemplars, tend to be more accurate in their perception. So we have some evidence from that. We want to look at it in the Black-white case in part because when we think this is happening, but the prototype is actually, if people came up with the most prototypical Black Americans, right, they should actually show a reduced wealth gap than what they seem to be doing. So we want to test it there. But that latter point I want to make is because, you know, even that sort of cognitive mechanism is motivated, right? You have to be motivated to think that it's close. Narrower, shorter, weaker, closer, the gap is smaller than it actually is, to call up Oprah and LeBron, right? The very same people, and we have some data on this, who overestimate racial equality the most, also overestimate the percentage of Black Americans who are incarcerated, right? So, right? Those two things literally cannot be true, right? And I should say, we define wealth for people before they do these estimates, just in case people don't know what wealth is and how it comes to be. So there's some cognitive stuff going on here. True, there's a lot of motivated cognitive stuff going on here. So that side, you know, the broadening people's socioeconomic and racial network diversity, I think, is really important. I started doing this work in part because I moved to New Haven and I was not yet habituated to the racial and class patterning of New Haven and Connecticut, right? It's not that Illinois is not that, Chicagoland doesn't have it, of course it does, but we all habituate to it and we get into our routines and it kind of falls away, right? And so when I moved, it was in my face and nobody else seemed to be shocked and appalled. Because they'd all lived here for so long, not nobody else, but you know what I mean. And so I think disrupting that habituation is important. A national service is one route. You know, my preferred route would be changing the racial and socioeconomic segregation of public schools, reinvesting in public schools, changing how they're funded so people actually get real exposure to other folks. And that's not seen as like a service project, that's seen as, you know, being kind of, you know, what life is like, you know, growing up in this country. Thank you.
Thank you. Marilyn Brewer.
Hi, Jenna. Really good to see you. And
good to see you.
I'm so impressed of this work that you've been doing. But one of the things that couldn't help but pop in my mind, speaking of availability, is how this, all the things you're talking about, especially the disruption possibilities of the Derek Chauvin trial that's going mm-hmm. on right now. We're all pretty aware of it, and everybody right now is a bit on edge about how it may come out. But the irony to me of one of some of the things you've been learning is that if he's found guilty, in particular, if he's found guilty of at least second degree murder, this is an opportunity for reinforcing, you know, the idea that, well, we're past that now. We've solved the justice problem. Now our justice system is on track again. So I would assume that is a potential case of what you're talking about. But the question I guess I have for you is, can you think of ways in which that could be counteracted? That is what we could do in the media or in academia to not allow that to be overweighted in people's perceptions of how much progress we're making in the criminal justice system, which probably along with the wealth gap is the other most dramatic place in which progress has not been made.
Yeah, great question and observation. And yeah, I also worry about that. In fact, I also worry about if Chauvin is convicted, the false assumption that means there's not systemic racism in policing, which is, you know, because one officer actually is held accountable. How to fix it? I wish I knew. We're working on it in our own data, in our own lab, and trying to come up with helping people acknowledge what is so. But it's difficult. It is very, as you know, threatening to the moral value of people's social identities as American, you know, as white American. But again, this is America's story. This is racial minorities show these overestimates too, not as large, but they show them and it's, you know, in part because we're optimistic, in part because we're hopeful. And we need to cling to something. So I'm not, you know, advocating pessimism per se, but vigilance, I guess, and recognizing that systemic, you know, structural policy, that's where what got us where we are, and, you know, time. And it's not going to be fixed by one-off, short-term, acute acknowledgements, right? The problem is structural, systemic, social policy. The solutions need to be structural, systemic, social policy, right? And really just kind of keep that in mind. Otherwise, I'm just generally like a bad party guest, although now we don't make parties, but before, when anybody would say something that like, we're back on track, or, you know, my favorite, once the old people die off, the young people don't have these issues, so they will fix it for us. I just, you know, talk about how that's wrong. And you should not count on that anyway. Like, you know, if we want to the society that we believe we have, right, we have to do what's required to make it so.
Bill Phillips next.
Thank you. And thank you, Jennifer, for that illuminating talk. What I'm wondering about is, what about other measures of racial inequality? For example, I'm thinking about maybe average family income. One of the things about average family income is, let's say you've got just enough. I don't know what that means. Let's say it's 20% of what the average family income is. Then your wealth is going to be zero because you have no chance of accumulating any wealth. But of course, it doesn't seem so bad on that scale because it's 20%. And what I'm wondering is whether people's perceptions of whether you have any data, but whether people's perceptions of income is also wrong. See, on the one hand, you might think that, well, people got the the fraction of wealth wrong by a factor of 10, but they got right that it was getting better. They just, you know, both in 63 and in 2016, it was wrong by a factor of 10. And of course, it wasn't monotonic either. But my guess is that average family income is actually getting worse relatively, because, you know, at least I've heard these numbers that the income gap between the top 1% and the bottom 40% has been growing. And so I'm wondering, what do you have in the way of data about that and about people's perceptions about that data?
Yeah, great question. Yeah, I you know, when you give these talks, you know, short amount of time, you cannot present everything. But yes, wealth looks the same. I mean, income looks exactly the same, meaning the patterns in terms of people's perceptions, they also impose this sort of linear progress story to it. For most of reality, you know, the reality numbers, the benchmarks, there has been more progress actually in income than wealth, right, until sort of lately, right? And now we have, it's widening again. But people are still wrong across every time point. They're significantly wrong. It's not as glaring as wealth, because the wealth gap is just so huge, you know. But the income does some interesting things that people do with income, some interesting things that are, I think, interesting. One, they're actually, on average, Americans are a little too pessimistic about the income gap in the past. So when you ask them about, you know, some early time, let's say 1963, they tend to overestimate inequality then, right? They're a little bit too pessimistic, which is interesting. And then of course they're too optimistic in the present, but of course that also allows for lots of progress, right? To doing that. And then they also do the same mental shenanigans about the past when you try to disrupt the narrative. So income is not, does not get out of that. But it's, you know, it's interesting and I should say, we've also looked at other markers, perceptions of wages, you know, so lots of economic markers. And it's also the case that people impose these misperceptions on other, you know, dependent measures. Again, how many, you know, Black faculty members there are, for instance, at institutions, people on boards, right? Lots of spaces in which the perception of progress and, more importantly, equality far outpaces what's reality. And interestingly, if you ask about what they think will be the case, you know, in 2025, it continues to be linear, even in the wake of, you know, what one might consider an awakening, that things, you know, there can be, you know, changes that aren't so positive, or at least in the same direction. So.
Shirley Malcolm.
Hi, thank you so much. Wonderful, wonderful presentation. I've been thinking a lot about the systemic nature of the problems that we're talking about. It's not just about wealth gap. It's about where we live, home value, that basically stems from a long history of redlining, public policies that have essentially put us in the place where these things perpetuate, where we live, where we worship, where we learn, what we study. I mean, it goes across everything around issues of incarceration, et cetera. Because we are actually living in different worlds, there are different realities, as it were. But there seems to be a problem with regard to people's willingness or motivation to look for facts, or to look at facts, or to accept facts. I mean, when a prominent public figure essentially says, well, that was a long time ago, when you in fact know that it was very recent, and that he is not living in the real world, the whole question about seeking facts, where will they seek facts? What will motivate them to seek facts? And will the facts actually be available? Because of the different worlds that people are living in, from whom will they accept evidence? And I know this, I have served on boards with people, and somehow the conversation came around to these issues. And when I made a statement, they were shocked at the statement because they thought something different. They were willing to accept it from me because they had known me for 15 years. And they knew that I was basically going to come at them from a basis in fact, but it was jarring. It was absolutely jarring in terms of it did not fit with their own narrative about what the real world was like. How do we get people to value evidence and to accept facts about what is going on, as opposed to kind of the public narrative of people who want things to appear to be good?
I think you get the Nobel Prize if you answer that question. you're so right. And accepting facts about anything in this moment is especially difficult, but accepting this fact. And and that's honestly one reason why we sort of zeroed in on the wealth gap as one marker to demonstrate some of this with. One, because it is so staggering. Two, because it is, it can't be explained away by, well, if only people worked harder, if only people went to school, right? You just cannot explain it away. It's too big for that. And it's so connected to, obviously, the intergenerational accumulation of resources. So you cannot say has not been affected by redlining, by Jim Crow, by slavery, right? It's just not possible to set all that aside. So that's one reason why we, focus so much on that gap in particular. But you're right. Our first paper came out in 2017, got a big to-do in the New York Times, and people could guess themselves and they were all wrong. So they in real time replicated the effect. And the immediate response, on Twitter was, this can't be right. Maybe it's this, maybe that. I did this with my class before the students, before when we were working on the paper, and my students didn't believe me. In class, they're Googling the black-white wealth gap instead of listening because they didn't believe me. So you're absolutely right. But I think, I'm hoping that at least the community of people who believe in evidence, believe in facts, will be receptive to the reality that is so. We're using federal benchmarks, right? Data collected by our government and economists who are looking at this as well. And, we'll be open to seeing this. I started this work because I couldn't help but see what was so in New Haven. And I clearly, I knew what was true in Evanston and Chicagoland, but I still, admittedly, had started not seeing it, right? So I think, sometimes it just needs to be presented again in our faces in some way. And then those of us who are willing to accept that are also, I think, at least in my experience, willing to recognize the operation of this narrative, right? The end, why we fall prey to it, because we want things to be better, because we want our society to be what we think it is, right? Because we do overweight the progress, the Barack Obama, the Kamala Harris, right? In this moment, we overweight that Warnock, Ossoff, right? And we underweight the very next day, right? And now we're seeing the fallout of that, Georgia trying to change the voting rules again, right? We pay a little bit of attention to that. Okay, now we're paying a lot of attention.
Yes, I live in Georgia.
Yeah, right. So and it's happening everywhere. So we're constantly, we, the people who think this is progress, want to do what it takes to engender a more just, equitable society. Focus on the wins, and yay, you got to celebrate the wins. They're few and far between. But then we do the, okay, we won, and walk away and get back to our lives. Whereas those who see the very same gains as, oh my goodness, no, this can't stand. We can't let it happen again. They get to work. And we're sort of not paying attention to that either. So, I didn't answer your question at all. I will not get the Nobel Prize, at least not this week. But I do hope that exposing these, the reality of the gaps and what keeps us so committed to being wrong about something really important will help penetrate the very, you know, acceptance of something so profoundly wrong, at least among some of us.
Let's see. Next up, Margaret Linen, I see. Margaret? Great.
Thank you, Jennifer. Was very, very interesting. I was really surprised not to see an increasing gap sort of after the war on drugs and three strikes. You know, when you incarcerate more than half of the breadwinners, why was there not a big increase in gap or decrease in Black family income as a result of that?
Yeah, a great question. The right answer is I'm going to turn to economists for the real answer to that, because they're the ones who are, you know, really producing these data. Intuition, one, this is wealth and not income. So, you know, it's just a different marker. But two, it's the numbers are so small. So you do see this fluctuation, but it goes from $5, right? 5% of the average family wealth of white families to 10, right? And there's sort of, you know, some up and down there. But the numbers are very strong. Are very small. So you can, you know, can only see so much movement. So it goes, you know, up from 10 to 5 to 10 to 5. But you also do have, you know, what offsets some of that, right? Are the actual real tangible and important outcomes of the civil rights laws, affirmative action. And so you do double the Black middle class across this period as well. You, for the first time, have a, I mean, not the first time, but you have significant increasing numbers of members of the Black middle class. So you're having, you know, some, you know, increases there while you also have these, of course, decreases. But the right answer was the first one. An economist would have to say exactly, you know, why that's the case, you know, and it's entirely possible that some of it is because of who is and who's not counted even in the data, to be honest.
Thank you.
Thanks. Mm-hmm. Diane Pinderhughes.
Thank you, Jennifer. This was a wonderful presentation. And I wanted to say what you just said, namely that I think some discussion with economists is going to be important. I recently saw a kind of a fight that developed, and I participated in it on social media, about the issue of how you define wealth, where one of the start came with somebody who was arguing that the extreme differences of race are associated with the top segments of each racial group, as if you control for the top levels, and that would eliminate this huge racial wealth gap, which I've been watching the data on this for many years, and know from the work of people like Melvin Oliver, Sandy Darity, and a number of others, that you don't, it doesn't matter what you control for, you know, even if you control for that by race, there are huge numbers of whites who are billionaires compared to the numbers of Blacks that are billionaires, and even the billionaire class is much bigger among whites than it is among Blacks. But so if you have a situation developing where you see economists trying to make an argument that you know is just wrong, and even people among this group, they're not here today, but somebody who's a member of the Academy who was participating in that were making the same argument that wealth is wrongly conceptualized or constructed. And I thought that was really, that really surprised me and annoyed the hell out of me. Thank you.
Yeah, no, I appreciate that. Yeah, I mean, you know, yeah. So I have two answers. One, I too defer to the expertise of the good Sandy Darity and Derek Hamilton. You know, but I also think it's important to consider why now are we trying to redefine wealth?
Yeah, I agree with that.
You know,
yes.
And so part of, you know, what we're trying to do, because, you know, we're psychologists, we're not economists, so we literally use what they do as benchmarks and, you know, not they, but the federal government. And just so there's some, you know, quote unquote accuracy, but we're only doing that, right, as a way to expose the psychology that's governing how we think about all this. So what does it mean that we're like, okay, but if you look at the billionaires, the gap is closed. All right, but you know what? In the United States, there are six Black American billionaires, six, period. And that's only because Jay-Z got added like last week, right? There's six. There are hundreds of white billionaires, right? So, okay, you want, I mean, one, it's not true. So it's, you know, it closes, right? When you start looking at billionaires, but it doesn't close all the way. And why would you, okay, so this discussion is irrelevant for those six people relative to everyone else, but actually still the like number one is still like not even at 10 billion of the Black billionaires. And of course that is not true for Mr. Bezos and Mr. Zuckerberg. And, you know, they're, you know, so much wealthier than even the wealthiest Black billionaire, right? So that's just, it is what it is. I have learned to exit stage left of Twitter fights, but it does expose, right, this discomfort with this particular staggering disparity, this reality that people are working themselves into knots to make it go away. And that's why I think wealth is so useful, because you can't make it go away. No matter how you look at it, it's, you know, where it goes. Well, the only place to go away is look at people at less than like 10, you know, $10,000 in income or wealth, and it's gone because they have no wealth, right? But, you know, okay, we'll concede that. We also think that, you know, we should be looking at economic inequality more generally, not just racial economic equality. So
good.
Thank you.
Thank you. John Romer, you've been patient. You have a question?
Uh-huh. Thank you. It seems to me that we're talking about what would make it go away. I'm an economist, and I think very few people understand what wealth is. It's a rather complicated concept. It's a stock, it's not a flow. For example, if you ask most people, should your mortgage be included as part of it, should be it subtracted from your assets to get your wealth? Probably very few people understand that they have to subtract the mortgage from their positive assets to get their wealth. And I think the income is so much in the news. It's fairly well known. I think a lot of people see there's a common statistic which is bandied about, which is the Black wage is about 70% of the white wage. I would bet that a lot of people therefore have the inference that the Black wealth is 70% of white wealth, which of course is completely false. People massively underestimate the ratio of the wealth of the top 1% to the average wealth in this country. So, which has nothing to do with racism. It has to do with a misunderstanding of what wealth is and a just complete ignorance about the massive inequality that exists with respect to wealth, much more than with respect to income. So I guess, I mean, in your work on this, I would want to have some fairly convincing tests that people understand what wealth is, the respondents understand it, and perhaps give people a little tutorial on it and make sure they can do some calculations before I ask them the questions to be more convinced that this was really a lack of that to understand whether this is really an issue of a misunderstanding of progress or a lack of understanding of the definition of the concept.
Yeah, great questions, and all absolutely true in everything you said. We don't test people about wealth, but we did define wealth before people gave their estimates. We also, you know, again, you can't say everything in these talks, but we also ask people to estimate general societal economic inequality, and we control for that. So people are just bad at this kind of thing. We, you know, kind of control for general ignorance. We did have in certainly the nationally representative sample and some of the other ones, a test of financial literacy, and we control for that. And it does predict, right? People who know more about this stuff do better, but it doesn't take away any of the effects that are relevant here, I'm talking about here. As I said earlier to someone's questions, we see the very same effects with income. And people are also wrong, despite well-publicized information, which actually, you know, of course, they're not as wrong, you know, as with wealth, but they're wrong. They're also wrong, not wrong. They show the same pattern with gender wage gaps, one of the most publicized, you know, differences with, you know, believing in this linear progress and patterning, overestimating that progress and what it means for the wage gaps today, and actually being a little bit too pessimistic about it, what it was, you know, in the 60s, right, and 70s. So this, there seems to be something going on that's more predictable, more ordered, more, I think, consistent with this illusion of social progress, in this case, racial, but also gender, than simply just a lack of sort of financial knowledge kind of more generally. But yeah, I mean, which is why we look at different markers, which is why, you know, all those reasons we control for these things. But yes, in general, people are bad at this kind of, these kind of estimates. That's why we also take the numeracy out of it, right? And we're using these sort of weird sliders because we don't want people trying to do calculations and things, because we know that also increases errors, right? So, I guess I could all just say to you is, one, I wouldn't be a real scientist if I didn't say we could be wrong. But right now, our data and that of lots of other people is consistent with this idea that there's this narrative of racial progress, of the progress of social progress that appears to be patterning how people think about this when asked, right? Which I think is also important, right? We're asking people to generate something that they don't think about all the time, which is also kind of weird, and changes, right? And sort of activate certain cognitions. I think those are interesting, that is not how normal, you know, things happen in the world normally. So we should always remember that. But consistent and compelling evidence that these are, these overestimates, this sort of optimism, this perception of this illusion is something that is real and hard to shake, especially the commitment to current society being pretty dang equal right now.
Thanks. Let's see, next I see Jim Moran. You have a question?
Yes, it's my wife, actually.
Hey, hi, Jennifer, thank you. Well, I'm a pastor in the whitest denomination in America, the Lutheran Church, Evangelical Lutheran Church in America. And Black pastor Lenny Duncan wrote a really influential book calling the denomination out for being so Eurocentric. So guess what? Day before yesterday, the monthly magazine of the denomination came out. And more than half the people pictured in there are people of color. that's not true. And I wonder, is that a help? That certainly is misleading. What do you think?
I think it's worthy of some conversations, right? What was the intention, right? To overcorrect for a lack of inclusion in past, you know, materials? Feature. And I think what you're pointing to is also an interesting something to consider, right? Meaning how we respond in this moment. And for many people, it's a moment of racial awakening, right? The George Floyd murder, this trial, the pandemic has revealed systemic inequality that many people didn't recognize it still existed. And many people want to do something about it. That's good. doing something about it in this moment, that's also good, but will it be a temporary and even overcorrection if the thing exists? And will that again be the, okay, we did something, now we don't have to think about it anymore, right?
Exactly.
So, you know, I wouldn't necessarily be over concerned about this particular, effort, but I think the question might be, you know, those in the room having these conversations, okay, what were we intending to do? And how will we know, were we successful? What else will we do, right? If this is about being expansive, increasing belonging, helping people identify and see themselves in the church, how will we follow up to make sure that is so, right? And, you know, what else will we do to continue to expand our efforts toward inclusion and community? We're a church. This is what we're supposed to be about. How else will we, what else will we do, I guess is the question I would ask, even in the wake of recognizing some awkwardness about what we might have just done.
Thank you.
I see three more hands raised. I'd like to try to get to all three of you if I can. So first, Roger Howe.
Hello. Yes, thank you very much for this very interesting exposition. I have a technical question. When people talk about average, I'm a mathematician, not a statistician, but still, when people talk about average, I'm always wondering whether they're talking about median or mean. And I mean, there's, in particular in things like wealth, there's a huge difference. I mean, I don't know about this issue, but just about in terms of income. I mean, the mean per capita income in the US is $60,000. And so if you figured, well, if you had a family of four with a per capita income, they would have an income of $250,000. But in fact, the median family income is about $70,000. I mean, if you're $250,000, you're way up there. You're in the 90%. So that's an important issue for me. And another question, a point I wanted to say is, so it seems that there was, in fact, real progress in the 20th century. Another guy raised the issue, are we talking about additive gap or ratio? And, from the 60s to now, so it went from 5 to 50 and 10 to 90, so that's roughly the same ratio. But anyway, in the 90s, it was almost up to 20%. And so, and then it went down again. And I'm wondering, what were the reasons that it went down? Was a lot of it connected with the, you know, the huge predatory lending and the
crash? Let's try to get right to the question, if we could.
Okay, so I'll just end with that question.
Yeah.
Okay, well, the second question is easy because, you know, again, I'm not an economist. And so I'm not, looking at what caused, fluctuations in the actual gap. I'm looking at perceptions of the gap now and across time, and the psychology that governs that. The first is also relatively straightforward. We ask about average because we're asking regular people who don't really know about means and medians. But what we do is we use the benchmark data that are based on median, because those are more conservative tests. And that's what we're actually comparing to. Okay. It turns out actually the racial wealth gap, if you use averages, it's slightly different, but it's actually not that different. So our results hold no matter which one you use, but we tend to use the median instead of the mean.
Thanks, okay. Next, I see Chaparuka Kusimba.
Thank you, Jennifer, for such an eye-opening conversation. I think our paths crossed in Chicago, and I was at the Field Museum for many years. And I think David mentioned the question of comparative examples, models from other places. And I think that I grew up in Africa. I was born in Kenya. And in the 60s, when we were growing up, there were very few schools. And our mothers did not know how to read and write. And so African, newly independent African nations realized that the only way you can change this is to correct the situation in the home. And so if you look at many, many schools in Ghana, Nigeria, Kenya, and many places, they started building boarding schools. I'm very, very aware of how politically bad, I mean, the notion of boarding schools, how it worked disastrously among Native American communities and in Australia. So there is no appetite for that. But even as we think about funding schools today, I think that one of the major problems we face is actually the home. That was very important. I think when you grow up around adults who read, around adults who have one job, and they're not running around from one job to the next, this is what really happens. And I'm saying this because in Chicago, I had interns, and I volunteered in a local high school in Kankakee County. And one of the things that I will do when I meet these kids is we'll get in my car and we'll drive to the north side because they've never been there. And I showed them how wealthy, successful people lived. And you could tell, just looking at the faces of these children when driving through Winnetka, Kenilworth, and all those places, this was a completely new world to them. I became an ardent believer that in order for us to change the situation with these young people who are growing up is perhaps to equalize the situation, perhaps go back to the idea of building boarding schools and having these, taking these kids away from home where they have the same resources, where they can learn and build themselves the confidence of reading, all of those things that we talk about, but are very hard to go into. And I think that if we take that first step, perhaps 50 years from now, we'll be talking about a real different situation. But I think there's not going to be a band-aid solution to the problem. We have to correct the problems that exist today in our communities in order to get these young learners to make friends with each other. And all of that. But that's what I'm going to say. Examples in places like Kenya, Nigeria, South Africa today, I think show that boarding schools do in fact change some lives. So one of mine where my mother was illiterate and yet she produced children who are, many of them are doctors, successful lawyers, and me in the American Academy, something totally unheard of.
Okay, I will agree with you that there are no band-aid solutions. I think boarding schools are probably a bit extreme and off the table. There are also lots of evidence that taking children away from their communities and families is really damaging psychologically. And of course, we're also living in a culture that, you know, has, you know, if you're looking, talking about, you know, Black kids, some, you know, still a large portion of people in the world who have anti-Black attitudes, and that we also know undermines children's education. So, you know, we'd have to think carefully, but what I would agree with you is increased investments in the communities and schools where people currently live in to make them better able to support the students who are there and to allow children to focus on learning and their families to support them because they're not having to work four jobs or worried about over policing or under policing, right? All of the things that parents working are worried about, that would, you know, I think provide the type of environments that, you know, lead all students to be able to learn, right? I think, you know, I certainly appreciate your story and it sounds incredible, but we don't need to look that far for successful models, right? My dad, his parents, you know, only went to fourth and sixth grade or something like that, because that's all that was available to them in rural Virginia, but they were adamant about their kids getting an education. And my dad, whose school ran out, his segregated public school, only went to the 11th grade. He still went to college, a historically Black college, and then he went to the military, and he's right. So, and now he has a child who's a professor at Yale, right? So we don't need to look elsewhere. The support and value of education has always been part of the Black American story, even though, of course, there's variance and there are deflections and there are people trying to live. And we can learn from that. And we can leverage that strength in community to create solutions. But people can't do it on their own. They need the support of, you know, the same resources that allow those Northern Chicago communities do well, which is the resources from their property taxes, right? If that type of resource, right, not for property taxes, were pumped into these public schools, right? Maybe we look in these communities more generally, maybe they would look a little differently.
Thank you. The very last question from Ken Ludmerer. Ken.
Yes, thank you, Jennifer, for the wonderful presentation and the wonderful work that you've been doing. I'd love to have the chance to talk about some of these things in person with you at some point. I have a particular interest in racial equity and medicine, but the question is both particular and general. In the search for solutions, in the search for greater racial equity and justice, do you see a role for the academic medical center in medicine or the university more broadly as an instrument of social change? And if so, what might their role be?
Oh, that's a really hard question. I'm almost certainly above my pay grade. But, you know, I'll answer it in a way that's probably unhelpful, but I fully believe it. I think there's a role for each of us to play in the, you know, achievement of racial equity in the domain, our spheres of influence, whatever that might be. So if you're in academic medicine and those in, yeah, what are you doing or not doing to, you know, to close these gaps, whatever the gaps that are relevant, you know, in your domain. I'm not trying to be cheeky, so the answer is yes, but whatever particulars of it, right, is something for each institution to think about, you know, to consider, right, and to implement as appropriate.
Good. Thank you so much. Let me close by thanking everyone for joining us in this conversation. And Jen, we really are grateful for your time, a very important conversation that we've had. So thank you, and goodbye to all of you.
Thanks, everyone. You.